In The Challenge of Paul, historical scholar John Dominic Crossan confronts centuries of doctrine and dogma to reveal the Paul of history. Paul, a first century Jew, trained in the letter of the law, who is then taught by women who welcome him into a community of Christ that leaves him radicalized and resistant to the greed and violence of the Roman Empire.
In the first series on The Challenge of Jesus, I didn't have to begin by justifying talking about Jesus. Paul needs some justification because for many people, and I'm talking Christians and non-Christians, Jesus is appealing and Paul is appalling. In the New Testament, there are 27 separate texts. Of those 27, 13 are letters attributed to Paul. Massive consensus in scholarship. I think the technical term for that's a miracle. You don't get it too often. When you get it, you pay attention. There's a great consensus that of those 13 letters, seven, are definitely, certainly from Paul, from the historical Paul. Then of the other six, three of them, Colossians, Ephesians, and 2 Thessalonians, this is debated, probably not by Paul. But then of the final three, 1 Timothy, 2 Timothy, and Titus, massive consensus again, certainly not by Paul. What you're getting in these later letters, these post-Pauline, these pseudo-Pauline letters, is actually anti-Pauline. What is going on is an attempt to de-radicalize the Jewish radical Paul, to pull him back into the normalcy of Roman culture, Roman civilization.
Dr. Crossan pushes his way past our preconceived notions about Reformation thinking and theology to place Paul squarely within the borders of the Roman Empire.
Put him back in his Roman matrix, out of the 16th, back in the first century. Let him speak the language that'll get him executed eventually. When I started to work on Paul in his own environment, Paul among the ruins of the Roman Empire, I started reading the primary texts of Paul in Turkey. That's where it happened. That's where it happened for me. That's when Paul came alive, because I began to understand that Paul was taking on the Roman Empire. This was not Christianity against Judaism. This was Christian Judaism against Roman imperialism. Paul is taking on imperialism. And of course, if Roman imperialism, then also American imperialism. So everything changed. Imagine if Paul wrote a letter to the Christians in America. I read that you talk about inalienable rights, God-given rights, rights from creation, life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, you mentioned. And you talk about being under God, with liberty and justice for all. And that I like that, because that's what the whole Bible is about, and that's what I've been writing about, liberty and justice for all under God. By the way, dear Americans, I do notice that you seem excited about this under God phrase. Don't worry about it. If you establish liberty and justice for all, you'll be under God whether you know it or not. But I'd like to ask you Americans a question, says Paul. How are you doing on inalienable rights for everyone in the whole world, apparently? How are you doing on liberty and justice for all?
Discussion starters and questions are available online and can be downloaded by all participants. An optional companion digital resource guide is available for teachers and group leaders to prepare for each session.
How many Pauls do we have? We have the historical radical Paul. We have the liberal Paul in the Acts of the Apostles. We have the conservative Paul in Colossians, Ephesians, and 2 Thessalonians. And then we have the reactionary Paul in Timothy and Titus. And you want to say, will the real Paul please stand up? But we know the answer. The real Paul is the radical historical Paul of those seven letters.